Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the SFL webinar series. My name is Chelsea Cravey, and I'm the director of the webinar series as well as an executive board member. Tonight, we're honored to have Dr. Sarah Skwire deliver a talk on Bloody and Invisible Shakespeare, Shakespeare and Adam Smith. Before we begin, though, I'd like to take a moment to introduce Students for Liberty and this webinar series. SFL is a 501c3 nonprofit organization run by students and for students dedicated to liberty. We were formed 4 years ago to serve a previously unfilled niche in our universities, where we connect liberty-friendly students with other students in their area, faculty, organizations, and we provide them with resources to help them advance their ideas on their own campuses, the ideas of classical liberalism. The resources that we offer include free books for student groups, handbooks on running student organizations, tabling kits, leadership trainings, an academic journal for Liberty and Society, and our conferences. And the fall semester is regional conference season, so if you're interested in seeing if there's one near you coming up, please look at our website, studentsforliberty.org. They're a great place to find other students and faculty in your area. This SFL webinar series is another one of our resources, and it's a way of giving everybody access to the ideas and mentorship and liberty from wherever you are. We hold webinars every other week to put you in touch with the top mentors and scholars for liberty in the country. If you want to see the full list that we have for this semester, you can visit studentsforliberty.org. And tonight's webinar is with Dr. Sarah Skwire. Sarah Skwire is the author of the college writing textbook, Writing with a Thesis, which is about to enter its 12th edition. She has won prizes for her poetry, which has appeared among other places in Standpoint, New Criterion, The Vocabulary Review, and The Vocabulary Review. Sarah has published a range of academic articles on subjects from Shakespeare to Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and her writing has appeared in journals such as as varied as Literature and Medicine, the George Herbert Journal, and the Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization. Recent pieces have appeared in Cato Unbound and The Freeman. She writes a twice-monthly book review column, Book Value, for The Freeman Online, and has lectured for FEE and IHS. Her research interests focus on the intersections of economics and literature, and Dr. Skwire is also a full-time fellow at Liberty Fund, a nonprofit educational foundation. So right before we start, just to tell you guys about what to expect, there will be 10 to 15 minutes of Q&A at the end of the webinar. So feel free to type in any questions in the question box on your control panel during the presentation. I won't be reading them out to the very end, but if you have one in mind, feel free to ask it while Dr. Skwire is talking. For those interested, this webinar will be recorded and archived on our website in the next few weeks. And without any further ado, I present to you Dr. Sarah Skwire.
Hi, everyone. I am delighted to be here, and I want to thank you all for tuning in tonight amid all of the distractions of hurricanes and Halloween. I know that some of you probably had to do a little extra work to get online or to a computer tonight, or even to possibly some electricity tonight, and so I do appreciate that effort. What I want to do tonight is to talk to you about a few of the ways in which Adam Smith uses Shakespeare's work in his own work. This is a topic that's of great interest to me personally, because Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations was one of the first economic works that I read. And as an English professor who was completely unfamiliar with economics, the frequent literary references charmed me, and they made the work feel human and lively in ways that I hadn't expected. So those references to Shakespeare and to other literature were really the bridge from my discipline into the discipline of economics that helped me find something of a footing in this new area of study, and an area of study that I had always found more than a little bit intimidating. Equally, as I've grown increasingly interested in the intersections of economics and literature, and as that has become increasingly my main topic of research, I remain impressed by the complexity and humanity that's brought to economics by writers like Adam Smith, like Bastiat, Hayek, Kirzner, Buchanan, and McCluskey, and other writers who, as Pete Betke puts it, fought persistently against the disappearance of the individual from economic analysis. These writers frequently have used the humanities to help in that fight. So that said, you can imagine how delighted I was the first time that someone pointed out to me that Smith's invisible hand is usually considered to be a reference to Shakespeare, and how that tip sent me racing through the rest of Smith's considerable body of work to track down more Shakespearean references. So tonight what I want to do is focus on three of those references, and here we have Shakespeare and Smith looking very gentlemanly for you. All of these references come from The Wealth of Nations and The Theory of Moral Sentiments, and all of them are references to a single Shakespeare play, particularly appropriate for the night before Halloween, the ghost and witch-laden Macbeth. Apart from its seasonal appropriateness, Macbeth interests me, and it seems particularly relevant to Smith's concerns because of its focus on the merits and the hazards of a particular human institution. But more about that as we get to the end of the talk. Let's start by looking at these references. Part one, The Invisible Hand. As I've noted already, Adam Smith's respect for literature as art and as example infuses all of his work. Whether it's The Theory of Moral Sentiments and its use of Shakespeare's characters Iago and Othello to discuss issues of human sympathy and fellow feeling, or the quotations from Milton and Dryden which begin Smith's essay on the history of astronomy, or Smith's references to plays like Phaedra, or epic poems like the Aeneid and the Iliad in his lectures in rhetoric and belles lettres, which are the notes from his most extended considerations of literature, Smith's use of literary reference throughout his work is constant. In a book called Adam Smith and the Virtues of Enlightenment, Charles Griswold points to the strong appeal that literature had for Smith as a way to speak about important contemporary moral concerns. He says, "Not only plays, novels, and poems, but tragedies in particular intrigue Smith. Together, they completely overwhelm his relatively rare references to properly philosophical texts. The notion that we are to understand literature and drama as sources for moral theory and moral education is clearly and strikingly evident in The Wealth of Nations as well." So Smith's attraction towards the literary as source material for moral arguments is easily seen if you just pick up any edition of The Wealth of Nations or Theory of Moral Sentiments or anything that Smith wrote, really, and you start poking through the footnotes. You're going to find myriad references to literature. And most of those references have been extremely well documented by the editors of the Glasgow edition, by Ryan Hanley in his edition of Theory of Moral Sentiments, for example. In her book, Economic Sentiments, Emma Rothschild outlines the most famous of the references when she examines the connection between Smith's idea of the invisible hand and the working of the same idea in Macbeth. She writes, "The earlier intellectual history of invisible hands turns out to be generally grim. The most famous invisible hand in Anglo-Scottish literature is that of Macbeth's. And with thy bloody and invisible hand, Macbeth says to the knight in Act 3, immediately before the banquet and Banquo's murder, he asks the darkness to cover up the crimes that he is about to commit." And there's the quotation for you. "Come, sealing night, scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand, cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale." Rothschild continues, "Smith, who lectured on Shakespeare's use of metaphor, is likely to have known Macbeth quite well." Rothschild further notes that The Wealth of Nations is full of anecdotes of secret self-interest in which the pursuit of material gain is uncovered behind the mysterious veil of self-delusion. But the anecdotes are directed above all against the wise and the great, against emperors and theorists, against the individuals who are their objects and subjects. She adds further that Smith's principal examples of self-interested behavior in The Wealth of Nations include manufacturers and incorporated towns, parish worthies, dukes of Cornwall, medieval kings, proud ministers, established clergy, and university professors. In other words, when Smith is worried about self-interest directed against people in damaging ways. He is worried about the self-interest of the wise and the great and the powerful. He's not worried about the self-interests of people without any power. Smith's reference to Macbeth and the invisible hand clearly fits in with this set of cautionary examples, and it emphasizes yet again how deeply entwined Smith's reference to Macbeth is with so many of the primary concerns of the wealth of nations. Now, it's worth noting here that Smith could have gotten the image of the invisible hand from sources other than Macbeth. Peter Harrison argued recently in the Journal of the History of Ideas that while the invisible hand was used in a variety of contexts, by far the most common involved reference to God's oversight of human history and to his control of the operations of nature. He says, almost certainly then, when readers encountered the phrase in Smith, they would have understood it as referring to God's unseen agency in political economy. Now, Harrison might be right about this, but I don't think so. I instead follow Rothschild in thinking that the numerous Shakespearean references in Smith, the applicability of Macbeth to his subject matter in Wealth of Nations, as well as two other Macbeth references on which I'll focus the remainder of the talk, are strong evidence that Smith had Macbeth and its natural, not divine, context for the invisible hand in mind. The invisible hand in Macbeth, you'll notice if you look at this quote, does not belong to God-fied nature. It belongs to night, not to God. Now, I do want to pause before I move on to the rest of these to share a couple of current references to the invisible hand, mostly because I think they're hilarious and I thought you guys would like to see them. This is my cartoon collection of invisible hand cartoons. So here are the sock puppets who believe there's an unseen hand behind everything that we do. The tip-top variety market, which has been bitch-slapped by the invisible hand of the marketplace and is therefore having a sale. And this is more or less me talking to my husband, suggesting that perhaps the unseen hand of the market will change the baby's diaper. Back to something a little more pertinent to our talk. Part two, collusion and corruption. And here are gentlemen in the smoke-filled room. Collusion and corruption are some of the most pressing themes in Shakespeare's play about Scottish kings written for a new Scottish monarch. They are also the deepest fears of all of us who believe that a free market functioning efficiently is one of the best solutions to human needs and desires. So it's no surprise then that when Smith, the Scottish professor of rhetoric and champion of the free market, worries about the vulnerability of that free market to human Now, in addition to explicit quotations from literature, like this reference to the invisible hand, Smith's writing, steeped in poetry, novels, and drama as it is, draws from the storehouse of his memory to allude to literature without giving a specific reference to the work of which he's thinking. He knows these works so well that they're part of his mental toolbox. They're just part of the set of paints that he turns to when he wants to create an effect. Discovery and examination of such an uncited reference can give careful readers better sense of Smith as a writer who instinctively turns to literature as a tool for his thought. Now, very early in Smith's Wealth of Nations, the reader encounters one such reference, previously unnoted in Smith's scholarship, during Smith's meditations on human nature, as demonstrated in comparison with the nature of dogs. This is an extremely famous passage in Wealth of Nations. It's elegant in its content and in its diction, and elegant as well in its explication of the social advantages and conveniency that arise from the human ability to truck, barter, and exchange with skills that dogs are able to use only to help themselves. Smith writes, and I want to put a chunk of this quote up. I'm not going to put the whole thing up, but I'll put sort of the core of the quotation up. I don't like PowerPoint slides that are all texts, so I do apologize, but I did want to have the chance to put the core of the quotation in front of you. I will start a little in advance of the quotation as it appears on the slide. Smith writes, By nature, a philosopher is not in genius and disposition half so different from a street porter as a mastiff is from a greyhound, or a greyhound from a spaniel, or this last from a shepherd's dog. Those different tribes of animals, however, though all of the same species, are scarce any use to one another. The strength of the mastiff is not, in the least, supported either by the swiftness of the greyhound, or by the sagacity of the spaniel, or by the docility of the shepherd's dog. The effects of these different talents and geniuses for want of the power or disposition to barter and exchange cannot be brought into a common stock, and do not in the least contribute to the better accommodations and conveniency of the species. Each animal is still obliged to support and defend itself separately and independently, and derives no sort of advantage from that variety of talents with which nature has distinguished its fellows. Among men, on the contrary, the most dissimilar geniuses are of use to one another. The different produces of their respective talents, by the general disposition to truck, barter, and exchange, being brought, as it were, into a common stock, where every man may purchase whatever part of the produce of other men's talent he has occasion for. Now, this passage has been analyzed often. If you have had a class on Wealth of Nations, or you have attended another webinar on Adam Smith or on the Wealth of Nations, you have probably considered this passage. This phrase, the general disposition to truck, barter, and exchange, if you don't memorize anything else in Adam Smith, this might be the piece to learn. It's enormously famous and hugely useful. Smith's comparison between the different specialized talents of specific dog breeds and the different specialized talents of different people is expertly contrasted with the inability of dogs to coordinate those specialized talents through the markets. While humans are able to truck, barter, and exchange in order to gain Now, some contemporary experimental economists, like Vernon Smith, have looked into modern studies of animal behavior, and they've actually found more cooperation among animals than Smith observed, which leads us to some interesting questions about how uniquely human such exchanges are. But what people haven't noticed in all of the time that they have spent examining this passage from the Wealth of Nations is that Smith's passage alludes to an equally well-known and important passage from Shakespeare's play Macbeth. For those of you who know the play Macbeth well, Adam Smith might have started thinking about, might have had the play brought to his mind by his use of, by his reference to the street porter early in the quotation, which would remind him of the famous porter scene in Macbeth's Act Two, right before Duncan is murdered. There's a long comic scene involving a drunken porter. For whatever reason it is that Smith is thinking of Macbeth, he's thinking of Macbeth. When in Act Three, Macbeth wants to hire a group of murderers to kill his best friend, Banquo, he discusses human nature with those murderers for hire in almost precisely the same terms that Smith uses in this passage that is currently on the screen. Here's the bit from Shakespeare. The first murderer, let's back up. Macbeth basically asks the murderers, are you men or are you dogs? Are you willing to boldly kill Banquo like men, or are you going to run away and hide like dogs? The first murderer says, we are men, my king. And Macbeth says, aye, in the catalogue ye go for men, as hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, shuffs, water rugs, and demi-wolves are clept all by the name of dogs. The valued file distinguishes the swift, the slow, the subtle, the housekeeper, the hunter, everyone according to the gift which bounteous nature hath in him closed, whereby he does receive particular addition from the bill that writes them all alike, and so of men. Now, the wording is similar. The dog breeds are similar. Even the subject matter is similar. In both cases, we're talking about the similarities among dogs, the similarities among men, and then requesting that the reader, the audience, the listener make a distinction among them. All of this suggests that as Smith wrote his passage on dogs and human nature, Shakespeare's discussion was in his mind. Now, this allusion to Macbeth serves to alert the readers to Smith's awareness of the corruptions to which a free market can be vulnerable. These are not reservations about the effectiveness of such a market. Rather, they are reservations about the damage and the amount of damage that can be done to an effective market by human action and imperfection. It's not the free market that's risky. What's risky is a free market that has fallen victim to collusion and corruption. Now, Shakespeare's first concern in this speech, and one of Smith's greatest concerns in Wealth of Nations, is collusion. I say it's Shakespeare's first concern because, of course, Macbeth is setting out to collude with these murderers in order to kill Banquo. Now, in the course of the play, here we have our collusion with Macbeth there on the left colluding with the murderers, and again back in our smoke-filled room with our colluding politicians or possibly capitalists. In the course of the play, Macbeth murderously colludes with three witches, with his wife, with the murderers for hire, and he attempts to collude with his best friend before he kills him. This speech about the dogs is given when Macbeth is persuading a group of murderers to kill Banquo and Banquo's son, who the witches have said will be fathers of the kings of Scotland after Macbeth. Now, this kind of hugger-mugger collusion, to steal an adjective from Shakespeare, this secretive and malevolent plotting by small groups seeking to work their way around good institutions, is one of Smith's primary concerns about the market. While Macbeth's efforts at collusion inevitably collapse and lead to his downfall, because collusion in the market is not done for the service of fictional dramatic ends, it's less predictably punished. Therefore, it's increasingly dangerous. Smith draws a bleak picture of the ways in which collusion among merchants can destroy the bonds that create a productive market. He writes, "We rarely hear, it has been said, of the combinations of masters, though frequently of those of workmen. But whoever imagines upon this account that masters rarely combine is ignorant of the world. Masters are always and everywhere in a sort of tacit but constant and uniform combination. These are always conducted with the utmost silence and secrecy to the moment of execution. Such combinations, however, are frequently resisted by a contractors all colluding against one another." A fine example of Smith's balanced and realistic assessment of the functioning of the market, this passage's bleakness is an important reminder to the likely audience of Wealth of Nations that it's not just their employees who seek to work around the market. In short, people of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment and diversion, but the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public, or in some contrivance to raise prices. The second problem for which Smith's Macbeth reference serves as a warning is the problem of the vulnerability of human institutions to human corruption. As the King of Scotland, Macbeth is the representative of one of early modernity's most respected institutions, the monarchy. While Shakespeare and other writers of his time were often conflicted over the specific virtues of specific monarchs, they generally felt that a divinely instituted and virtuous monarchy was the ideal form of government, one of the places where I tend to disagree with Shakespeare. Smith is similarly hopeful about the potentially useful duties of a good sovereign, the duty of protecting the society from the violence and invasion of other independent societies, the duty of protecting as far as possible every member of the society from the injustice or oppression of every member of it, the duty of establishing an exact administration of justice, the duty of erecting and maintaining certain institutions which can never be for the interest of any individual or small number of individuals. Now, Macbeth violates each of these duties. Indeed, he himself is the violence and invasion against which Scotland must be protected, and which inspires the further invasion that ends his reign and ends the play. But it's not the institution of monarchy that Smith's primary preoccupation. It's the market. His discussion of problems that have historically plagued the market, however, returns him again and again to a consideration of the problems that attend the monarchy. During his discussion of the origin and use of money in Wealth of Nations, Smith criticizes the irresponsibility of princes who debase the currency of their nation to pay their debts and fulfill their engagements with a smaller quantity of silver than would otherwise have been requisite. Their creditors were really defrauded. A monarch who debases his currency debases his reputation. This debasement is only emphasized by the fact that the monarch is often personally the least financially responsible person in the nation. Smith writes, "It's the highest impertinence and presumption in kings and ministers to pretend to watch over the economy of private people and restrain their expense. They are themselves always, and without any exception, the greatest spendthrifts in the economy. Let them look well after their own expense, and they may safely trust the private people with theirs. If their own extravagance does not ruin the state, that of their subjects never will." The parallel to Macbeth's corruption of the responsibilities of a sovereign is clear. Money and the market, like the monarchy, are frighteningly vulnerable to corruption by wicked individuals. And there we have our corrupt king and our corrupt marketer. Part three. None can call our power to account. The invisible hand connection and the colluding and corrupt dogs connection mean that it was particularly a great pleasure to me to find recently another reference to Macbeth in Smith's great book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. In his section on the effects of prosperity and adversity upon the judgment of mankind with regard to the propriety of action, great chapter title, Smith gives an extended account of the dangerous risks associated with desiring too rapid and easy a rise to a position of wealth and esteem. And again, I want to give you part of the quotation. It's a long quotation from Smith. I do want to read it because it's important to hear it. I want to put the core of it up so that you guys can have the core and can have the site for it if you're interested. I will start a bit before the site on this slide. "To attain the envied situation, the candidates for fortune too frequently abandon the paths of virtue. For unhappily, the road which leads to the one and that which leads to the other lie sometimes in very opposite directions. But the ambitious man flatters himself that in the splendid situation to which he advances, he will have so many means of commanding the respect and admiration of mankind, and will be enabled to act with such superior propriety and grace, that the luster of his future conduct will entirely cover or efface the foulness of the steps by which he arrived at that elevation. In many governments, the candidates for the highest stations are above the law, and if they can attain the object of their ambition, they have no fear of being called to account by the means by which they acquired it. They often endeavor, therefore, not only by fraud and falsehood, the ordinary and vulgar arts of intrigue and cabal, but sometimes by the perpetration of the most enormous crimes, by murder and assassination, by rebellion and civil war, to supplant and destroy those who oppose or stand in the way of their greatness. They more frequently miscarry than succeed, and commonly gain nothing but the disgraceful punishment which is due to their crimes. But though they should be so lucky to attain that wished-for greatness, they are always most miserably disappointed in the happiness which they expect to enjoy in it. It is not ease or pleasure, but always honor of one kind or another, though frequently an honor very ill understood that the ambitious man really pursues. But the honor of his exalted station appears, both in his own eyes and in those of other people, polluted and defiled by the baseness of the means through which he rose to it. Though by the profusion of every liberal expense, though by excessive indulgence in every profligate pleasure, the wretched but usual resource of ruined characters, though by the hurry of public business, or by the prouder and more dazzling tumult of war, he may endeavor to efface, both from his own memory and from that of other people, the remembrance of what he has done, that remembrance never fails to pursue him. He invokes in vain the dark and dismal powers of forgetfulness and oblivion. He remembers himself what he has done, and that remembrance tells him that other people must likewise remember it. Amidst all the gaudy pomp of the most ostentatious greatness, amidst the venal and vile adulation of the great and of the learned, amidst the more innocent, though more foolish, acclamations of the common people, amidst all the pride of conquest and the triumph of successful war, he is still secretly pursued by the avenging furies of shame and remorse. And while glory seems to surround him on all sides, he himself, in his own imagination, sees black and foul infamy fast pursuing him, and every moment ready to overtake him from behind. Now, if you're familiar with the story of Macbeth, I think that it will be easy to see that this long passage from Smith's theory of moral sentiments is essentially a plot summary of the entire play. While Smith follows this section of theory of moral sentiments with a reference to Caesar, I think that Macbeth was very much on his mind as he wrote it. The outline of the story he tells here is the outline of the play. Overcome with desire to become king and prodded incessantly by his wife, Macbeth murders King Duncan, forsaking the path of virtue for the path of fortune. And he is, for the remainder of the play, miserably disappointed, as Smith says, in the results. For while he does become king, Macbeth is, as Smith says, in his own eyes and in those of other people, polluted and defiled by the baseness of the means through which he rose to it. As another character in the play, Angus, notes of Macbeth later in the play, now does he feel his secret murders sticking on his hands. Now does he feel his title hang loose about him like a giant's robe upon a dwarvish thief. And surely, Macbeth's encounter with the ghost of his murdered best friend, Banquo, at an ostentatious banquet held in Macbeth's honor, and Lady Macbeth's famous sleepwalking scene are best described as those characters being, quote, secretly pursued by the avenging furies of shame and remorse, and while glory seems to surround them on all sides, he himself in his own imagination sees black and foul infamy fast pursuing him, and every moment ready to overtake him from behind. Or, to put it in Shakespeare's terms, unnatural deeds do breed unnatural trouble. Equally, Macbeth and Lady Macbeth's repeated pleas for the return of their ability to sleep peacefully are echoed in Smith's, he invokes in vain the dark and dismal powers of forgetfulness and oblivion. This is also suggested by Macbeth's continued recourse to the witches for political information, assistance, and prophecy. But the passage in Smith has more than just a plot line in common with Macbeth. Scholars have long noticed the prevalence of the words fair and foul in Shakespeare's play. The witches shriek, fair is foul and foul is fair, hover through the fog and filthy air, before they go flying off of the stage after the play's opening scene. And the very first words spoken in the play by Macbeth, just a few lines later, are, so foul and fair a day I have not seen. Smith's repetition in this long passage that I've just read to you of words like foul and defiled sound a chime with readers who are familiar with his work and with Shakespeare's. Now, the most telling connection, though, I want to put up here on the screen in kind of parallel blocks so you can see it. This most telling connection is Smith's assertion that in many governments, the candidates for the highest stations are above the law, and if they can attain the object of their ambition, they have no fear of being called to account for the means by which they acquired it. This is inarguably Macbeth's assumption about his status at the beginning of the play. He believes that he is so powerful, he is so significant, that if he murders the current king and attains the throne of Scotland, no one is going to call him out for it. And when Lady Macbeth sleepwalks and revisits the arguments that she used to help persuade Macbeth to murder King Duncan and take the throne of Scotland, she uses the same phrasing that Smith does here, to ask why they should even bother being afraid of being caught. What need we fear who knows it, when none can call our power to account? It would be more surprising, perhaps, if someone who knew Macbeth as well as Adam Smith did, and who already had the play in mind when working on Theory of Moral Sentiments, did not reference it during a discussion of ambition. For what more powerful literary representation of the evils of vaulting ambition which o'erleaps itself and falls on the other side could there be than Macbeth, who declares, "For mine own good, all causes shall give way." Part 4. So what? Skeptical cat regards my tale with suspicion. When I was in graduate school, my dissertation director always told me that the most important part of a paper was the so what. This is advice which every good dissertation director, every good writing instructor, every good academic advisor will give a student. You always need a so what. In this case, all right, so there are some connections between Wealth of Nations, Theory of Moral Sentiments, and Macbeth. So what? It's a good question to ask. So here are some so whats. So what, number one. The references in Wealth of Nations and Theory of Moral Sentiments to the shared references to the single play of Macbeth help to strengthen the connections between Wealth of Nations and Theory of Moral Sentiments. An inordinate amount of ink has been spilled over the quote-unquote Adam Smith problem, which is the idea that Wealth of Nations is self-interested, market-oriented, purely practical, while Theory of Moral Sentiments is sympathetic, emotional, other-oriented, and philosophical, and that these two works do not go together. That Smith underwent some sort of conversion, that he meant one seriously and was kidding about the other one, that there is some sort of innate disjunction between these two works by the same thinker. Now, the whole idea of this problem is a highly suspect misreading of Smith. As experimental work by Vernon Smith, historical work by people like Deirdre McCluskey, and the work of scores of other Adam Smith scholars in philosophy and history of economic thought suggests. But that said, the Macbeth evidence is suggestive, at least, that Smith himself saw similar concerns and considerations lying behind both works. It's one more piece of evidence that maybe there isn't that much of an Adam Smith problem after all. So what, number two? For those who are interested in studying Adam Smith as a philosopher and as a humanist, as a lecturer on rhetoric, as a lecturer on literature, as well as an economist, tracing out his literary references gives us, as I have said, a sense of his mental toolbox, a sense of the things that he tended to be thinking about, which can help us to contextualize his thought in some intriguing ways to our readings of Adam Smith. Now, the last and maybe the most important thing that these references can do is to give you guys some nice ammunition against people who would of ruthlessness. And it's a very simple piece of ammunition. And I've got it on a slide for you right there. Shakespeare's invisible hand, the invisible hand that many of us think is most likely the invisible hand that Smith is referring to. That invisible hand is a bloody and invisible hand, and its mysterious workings in Macbeth are violent and wantonly destructive. Blood leads to blood. Smith's invisible hand is clean. There's no blood. There's no violence. And there's no wanton destruction. And my faith in Students for Liberty is that you guys are able to run that distinction out from there. So I'm going to leave that somewhat revolting Halloween-y slide up there on the screen for a bit, and I will turn it over back to Chelsea for questions if there are any, and I'll thank you very much for your time.
Great, thank you so much. I love the Halloween theme and all the bloody pictures. This is perfect. So before we start Q&A, I'll give people a few minutes to type in their questions, and I'll talk about the response blog post that we would like to post on our blog if anyone is interested. After our webinars, if you want to continue the conversation about it, and if you have any big thoughts, or you want to sort of maybe contribute your own take on a certain piece of literature that might be related to this, then we would love it if you would write up a blog post and send it to our blog manager. It's Casey Given, C-G-I-V-E-N at studentsforliberty.org. We'd love to post that. So I'll ask the first question for you now. Do you have any other examples within Shakespeare or maybe outside of that in literature where these themes can be found? And what about other mediums of art as well?
If we're talking about, I'm going to assume that the question is about general economic themes in literature. Yes?
Yeah, yes, I believe
corruption
so.
Corruption and collusion. I'm going to go with general economic themes in literature. Excuse me. There are tons that I could do this all night. I will not. Some of the writers or genres of literature that I am particularly interested in as being specifically interested in economic themes. I did a talk this summer for Fee about Charles Dickens and about his reputation, which is enormously anti-market. I feel that that's not a fair representation of Dickens, so there's a lot of work to be done on Dickens and the market. There's a good deal more of him than just Ebenezer Scrooge and the Christmas Carol, and a lot more than just Hard Times. Anthony Trollope is another great Victorian novelist who I think is not much assigned these days because, like Dickens, he writes these enormously long novels. But he's quite interested in economic themes. Some particular works of his that would be of interest. I just did a review for my book value column at the Freeman Online, which went up today, of a short satirical Trollope novel called The Struggles of Brown, Jones, and Robinson, which is about a small shop and their attempts to make advertising work for them. You also might like the Eustace Diamonds, which is a property rights question and turns on questions about hereditary property and women's rights, women's right or lack of rights to own property. Some genres that I'm particularly interested in, I'm fascinated by, in the early 20th century, there's an enormous genre of fiction by women for women focusing on women going out into the workforce. You can call them shop girl novels if you like. Those are enormously economically interested. I feel like a lot of that economic interest carries over into contemporary romance novels. That's probably enough suggestion that I could do this all night. There's tons of poetry. Once you start looking for it, you will find economic discussion everywhere in literature.
Great. So the next question is, some argue that the prophecies that the witches present become self-fulfilling. Does Smith have anything to say in reference to self-fulfilling prophecies?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that offhand. My guess would be that Smith does not have a lot of patience with prophecy as something that is actual prophecy. I don't see him as someone who's got, I can't think of moments where he's particularly thrilled by notions of magic and prophecy and that sort of thing. He's more, he's more practically minded. He's more oriented to the human rather than to the supernatural. So he would probably fall on the side of those who would be liable to think that Macbeth hears the prophecy and then goes running from there.
Okay, next question that we have is, to what extent can we say that Smith was explicitly thinking of Shakespeare versus it just being an unconscious part of his mental toolkit?
It's a good question. As is evident from the talk, I'm not super specific about that. I think it's a tricky argument to make. We have a lot of places where Smith is very explicit about referring to Shakespeare. He mentions characters by name, for example, Iago and Othello. Caesar he may be getting from a variety of sources, but he may be thinking of Julius Caesar. It's hard to say how consciously he's doing it, or how much of this is a question of he's so familiar with the plays, he's thinking about things that relate to the plays, and the phrasing comes out. But I'm inclined to think it's poised somewhere neatly between the two, that if he had wanted to do a direct and explicit discussion of, say, the full plot of Macbeth, he probably would have. But on the other hand, it seems to me that he got started thinking in those directions about ambition not being called to account, and he almost finds himself writing the plot summary of Macbeth without even really knowing he's doing it, because it's just that familiar to him.
Okay, next question is, part of Smith's rhetorical power is his storytelling, and this makes his ideas all that more compelling. Who would you say are the greatest lesser-known economic storytellers?
Well, there's Bastiat, certainly, who is enormously important and I think becoming increasingly known as his works become easier to get. He's spectacular. There are particular articles that I like a lot for economic storytelling. There's a great article by Ronald Coase on lighthouses, which is about the question of whether a public good can be provided privately. And he looks at the history of lighthouses and how they were provided and how they were provisioned and how they were paid for. And it's absolutely fascinating. It's a gripping article and a great piece of economic storytelling and a great work of economics by a great economist. So that's one I would particularly point people to. And I think there's very good economic storytelling going on today. Pete Leeson's work on pirates. Steve Horwitz, who's been posting a bunch lately about Hurricane Sandy, but who did some phenomenal economic storytelling about Walmart versus FEMA in the Katrina recovery. What was that, 7 years ago? So there's a lot of good current contemporary economic storytelling that is getting done. That's well worth looking for.
Okay, the next one is, Shakespeare was canonized in the mid-18th century, and I think you're right that it's not surprising to find a big Shakespeare presence in Adam Smith. It's also the century when England was trying to incorporate Scotland politically and socially into its empire. Is there a nationalist dimension to his transformation of the invisible hand? A lot of people read Macbeth as deeply critical of the Scots.
Oh, that's a really complicated question. Wow, okay. So first let's think about Macbeth and Scotland, because Macbeth is written just as James I of England, James VI of Scotland, is taking the English throne. So Queen Elizabeth I has died after a bazillion years on the throne. And James, this Scottish outsider, has come in to take over the throne of England. So it's a politically fraught moment. What happens with those politics in Macbeth, to attempt to make a very long story a somewhat less long story, is that Shakespeare gives Macbeth this vision of the future history of Scotland, and Macbeth, the bad guy, sees his line coming to an end with him. He will not have any heirs who will become kings of Scotland. The line of kings is going to go through Banquo's heirs. Okay, Macbeth's slaughtered best friend is going to be the father of these future kings, because when Banquo is slaughtered, his son escapes and he runs off to England, and it's all very complicated. But eventually, Banquo is going to be the guy who is the ancestor of the future kings of Scotland. King James, proudly, and perhaps, you know, making it up, as we often do with genealogy, King James proudly traced his family tree all the way back to Banquo. Okay, so I don't think that the play Macbeth is critical of the Scottish royal family. Now, whether Shakespeare is critical of the Scots in general is an interesting question, because in general, people from north of the British Isles, the Irish and the Welsh and the Scots, get a pretty bad rap in a lot of Shakespeare plays as being vulgar, hard to understand, extremely violent, and that violence is certainly evidenced in the play, and potentially not that bright. So that's Shakespeare and the Scots. Now, does Smith make any nationalist capital out of the image of the invisible hand? That's an exceptionally good question, and I have absolutely no idea. I don't know Smith's thinking about Scottish independence or about the creating of a United Kingdom. I simply don't know. But now I really want to find out. That's a really good question.
The next question is a follow-up to the previously asked question about whether or not it was unconscious on the part of Smith. And the follow-up question is, was Macbeth so well known to Smith's audience that he would just assume that they would understand the reference?
I think he would have assumed that they would know the invisible hand, that they would get the invisible hand reference. I think that it is reasonable to think that they would have heard the line about called to account and ambition, and their ears would have pricked up. That would be the majority of Smith's readers. People who knew the play better, somewhat better, would have picked up the dog reference, I think. But the invisible hand and the calling the power to account, those are such famous moments in the play and such consistently quoted, consistently referenced speeches. And they come at such dramatic turning points in the play that I think anyone familiar with the play would remember them. And certainly you can assume among most of Smith's readers a high amount of education and a much greater familiarity with Shakespeare than we have in the 21st century.
Okay, well, great. That's all the questions we have for you, actually, which is pretty good timing so that we can finish before 9.
Yeah, that couldn't be much better.
So thank Yeah, so thank you so much, Dr. Skwire, and thank you to everyone who asked a question and participated. I think it was a really great presentation and webinar, and I hope all of you can continue coming back to our webinars and learn more throughout the year. On a quick final note, shortly everyone will receive a follow-up email where you'll find detailed information about our next webinar, which is in 2 weeks, and it's with Dr. Michael Humer on the topic, The Duty to Disregard the Law. You'll also receive a very short survey to evaluate the webinar. It'd be so helpful if you guys could fill it out. It'll only take about a minute. It's very short, and it helps us improve our program and make these webinars as interesting as possible for you. So with that, we're officially wrapped up. Thank you again to Dr. Skwire for this presentation.
Well, and thank you all for having me. It was a delight.
Great. I'm so happy that you had a good time. So have a wonderful night, everyone, and I hope to see you guys in 2 weeks.